Okay, hello everyone. My name is Devajyoti Vishwas, and with my friend Rahul Gupta, we will discuss the week 9 and revise some portions of it. As you all know, week 9 is dealing with graph theory, and in this video, we will discuss the basics, like the basic terminology, breadth first search algorithm, depth first search algorithm. With that, we will end this short video, and after that, in another video, we will start from these endpoints and this point, and we'll finish the remaining topics. So, without further ado, let us dive in right onto the subject. So, as you know, graph theory in mathematics and computer science is the study of the graphs. Let me just get my pointer. Yeah. So graphs are mathematical structures which are used to model pairwise relations in between objects. Now the question remains, what kind of objects? So graph is actually made up of two types of objects, vertices and edges. So we can represent a graph G comprising of V and E, two sets V and E, where V is a set of vertices or nodes, right? Or points also it is called. So as you can see, this blue graph, this triangle, is made up of three vertices. This is one vertex, this is another vertex, this is another vertex. So these three vertices and E is the set of the edges. So edges are also called links or lines, and edge is actually associated with two vertices. As you can see here, this edge is associated with two vertices. So graph is made up of vertices which are connected by edges. Now, what application is of graph theory? Why do we need it? So graph is actually applied in various aspects. So you can find it in different real life scenarios, a family structure, a social media network, a website design, a website structure, an electrical connection of a city or a power station, all of them can be represented with different graphs. One small example we are showing here. So this is a small electrical circuit in figure 1. You can see that if we take vertices as A, B, C, D, E and F, then the resistors which are lying in between these points can actually be considered as an edge. So we can consider the resistor which is giving a resistance to the current passing in between these two vertices A and F or A and B. We can consider them as edges. So A to F, there is one edge. A to B, another edge. B to F, another edge. B to C, an edge. CF, CE, EF, DE, CD, all are edges. So this is one application, a very, very small, minute application of graph theory. We will, in the last slide of this lecture, show different, we will just touch upon different applications once. Now, there are two types of graphs. So now, let us look at two different types of graphs. A directed graph or a digraph is a graph in which the edges have orientations. So you can see this graph has three vertices, and three vertices, each of them have directions. So a directed graph is an ordered pair G equals to V comma E, where V is a set of vertices. So this is a vertex 1, this is another vertex, this is another vertex. So in a real life scenario, you can imagine that these are three cities. So one is Kolkata, one is Delhi, and one is Chennai. So, and these edges represent different airline connection routes. Okay. So this edge represent that Kolkata to Chennai. Suppose this is Kolkata and this is Chennai, then Kolkata to Chennai has a airline connectivity. So one flight goes from Kolkata to Chennai, but no flight comes back from Chennai to Kolkata. Suppose this is Chennai to Delhi. This is a bidirectional edge. So that means Chennai to Delhi and Delhi to Chennai, there are both way flights available.
So, Deepjyoti, I mean, as you are saying that if there is a direction, then there is a flight, I mean, in a physical significance that we are representing nodes as cities and arrows that there is a flight. That is the physical significance right now for this graph. Okay,
yes.
So, in below graph, you have not given any direction. What does it mean?
So, for an undirected graph, that represents, the edges represent that there are both way connectivity. So, if these are the three cities, suppose Kolkata, Delhi and Chennai, then this represents that there is a two-way connectivity. And the edges represent airline connectivity. Then Kolkata to Chennai and Chennai to Kolkata, there is a connection. Whereas Delhi to Kolkata, Kolkata to Delhi and Delhi to Chennai, Chennai to Delhi, connections are there.
So what I can understand from your explanation is that if there is a direction, then a point is visible from the its previous point from where the arrow is shown. But in bidirectional, I mean undirectional graph, every vertex is reachable, every pair is reachable from each other. Is that
yes, exactly. So the edges in the directed graph will have arrows representing the directions associated. In undirected graph, we do not have arrows associated with it, and that represents a bidirectional connectivity. Okay, let's go to the next slide. So next slide, we have another concept called degree of a graph. So in this slide, we are discussing this degree of a vertex, or the vertex of a graph. So the degree of a vertex of a graph is the number of edges that are incident to the vertex. Now, there is a particular type of graph called a complete graph. A complete graph is a simple undirected graph in which every pair of distinct vertices is connected by a pair of unique edges. So here you can see all the vertices, I mean all the vertices are connected by singular set of edges. So there is no two edge between two vertices. Okay. So a complete graph is a simple undirected graph in which every pair of distinct vertices is connected by a unique edge as shown. So in such a graph with n number of vertices, all vertices of them will have a maximum degree of n minus 1.
So
suppose this,
you are saying that in a particular graph, a particular vertex can have maximum n minus 1 degree.
Means n minus 1.
It can be maximally connected with n minus 1 vertices, what I can understand.
Yes.
Okay.
So, can you calculate this? I'll just go back from the presentation. 1 minute. Can we calculate the degree of these vertices? So
I can see C is not connected with any other vertices, so degree should be 0.
Yeah, so the degree of C is 0. What about say E?
E is connected with G, F and B. So
no, G, G also.
G, F and B.
Ah, B, F and G.
I can see it is connected with 3 vertices, so 3 degree.
So the degree is 3. What about G?
E and F, so 2.
So that is how, guys, we calculate the degree of the vertices. Okay, let's get back to the presentation. Yeah, so I guess the students can check the degree of the other vertices as well. Okay, another slide. Yeah, right. So, in a directed graph, we have two different degrees. So, one is an in degree, another is an out degree, right? So, the number of arrow headings adjacent to a vertex is called the in degree. So, what do we mean by that? what we see is the for any vertex, the number of arrowhead aims adjacent to a vertex is called the in degree of the vertex. So this is the head of an arrow and this is the tail of an arrow. So to any vertex, the number of arrowheads which are coming incoming, that is the in degree. So at C, the two arrows are coming inside C. So one is from B and another is from D, right? So what will be the in degree of the C vertex, Rahul?
I think it is coming from B and coming from the two incoming arrows, so two in degree.
Yes, and from C another one arrow is outgoing, so that is called the out degree of the vertex. And so what is the out degree here of C?
One.
Yeah, exactly. What about A, the vertex A?
So again two in degree and one out degree.
Great. So, just a small notation. So, in degree is represented with degree to the power minus symbol. As you can see here, degree to the minus symbol of the vertex. Maybe vertex A or vertex B or whatever degree of to the power minus A. And out degree is represented with positive. So, degree to DG to the power positive. This is just a notation. Okay. Now we have a walk. So walk is a finite or infinite sequence of edges which joins a sequence of vertices. So for our case, I think only finite sequences we are seeing in our course. So it joins a sequence of the vertices. So suppose V1, V2, V3, V7, V4, V5, V6, these are the vertices. Now if we start a path from V2 to V1, V7, V3, V4, V5 and V6, then that is actually a path. Now a path is a walk in which all vertices and therefore also all the edges, they are distinct. See, in this diagram, none of the edges are same. V1, V2 is a distinct edge. V1, V7 is a distinct edge. V7, V3 a distinct edge. And V3, V4, same goes for other edges as well. So a path is a walk in which all the vertices and therefore all the edges are distinct. And paths are sequence of these connected edges. V2, V1, V1, V7, V2, V1, V7, V3, V4, V5, V6. This is one path. So the mathematically path is a sequence of vertices and connected, which are connected by the edges. So we can go from one vertex to another vertex. So VI, V comma VI plus 1. So we can go from V1 to V2 or like that. So in this vertex, it is not, the notations are not like that. But that is one way we can write. But you just remember that path is a walk in which all vertices and therefore all the edges are distinct. And one vertex is reachable from another vertex if there is a path from the first vertex to the second one. So vertex V, any vertex V is reachable from a vertex U if there is a path from U to V. Okay. So with that, we end up the terminology part and we go to the algorithm, the first algorithm, that is breadth first search.
Yes.
In this slide, I just want you to find, this is actually a map of southern Germany with some connection between the cities. You can see Frankfurt, Mannheim, Karlsruhe, okay, Nuremberg, Kassel, Stuttgart, these are the cities. So I want you to find a connection, a path between Frankfurt to Stuttgart where we have to cross the minimum number of cities in between. Frankfurt to Stuttgart, minimum number of cities in between. So what are the different ways do you think we can go to here, Stuttgart?
So I think I can take the first leftmost part. Mm-hmm. So I'll have to cross Mannheim,
okay,
then Osburg, and four
Munich, Nuremberg.
And Nuremberg.
Huh, or
and five. I think five I'm getting with this way.
Okay.
And then if I go left, rightmost, then Kassel, and then again 1, 2, 3, 4.
Huh.
So four cities I need to cross. So earlier was five and now it is four. Oh, I can okay. see one path from the middle also.
Okay.
And from middle it is 1, 2. It only two cities I can cross and I can reach. But what I did, I could not come to this conclusion in one shot.
Yes, yes, exactly. Huh. So there, yeah.
It should not be happening because if we
it's
can.
It's a hit and trial without.
Yeah. Yeah. If we can find some kind of algorithm and which shows that this is the minimum number of cities required,
mm-hmm.
I think that would be great. Huh?
Yeah, yeah. So for problems like this, what we have is a breadth first search algorithm. So breadth first okay. search is an algorithm with which we can create a tree, which is another form of graph, right? And with which we can find what is the minimum number of vertex we can cover we can cross to reach to a particular vertex. So like Frankfurt to we were going to Stuttgart. So Frankfurt, then this node, Würzburg, Nuremberg, and then Stuttgart. Okay.
Oh.
If we want to go to
I can see that we are getting the minimum number of paths in one shot.
Yes, 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 exactly. Mm-hmm. So now for this kind of applications, we have this algorithm called breadth first search. So we will discuss a little on breadth first search algorithm.
Yeah, yeah.
So breadth first search, I'll just pause this animation for the time. So breadth first search is the search algorithm. Sorry, I wrote the minimum number of vertices to traverse from one particular vertex to another distinct vertex. So how do we explain this? So we explore the graph level by level. Okay. So we first visit one vertex, which is one step away from the root node, then two step away from the root node. That is why how we go. So one node or one vertex is taken as the root node. So here, like in this case, we started from Frankfurt. So Frankfurt is the root node.
Okay.
Okay. Then we went from one node to another node. So we went to Mannheim, we went to Würzburg, we went to Kassel. These are the three ways we can go. Then where can we go from Mannheim to Karlsruhe? Whether we can go from Mannheim to any other place? No, only Karlsruhe. Whether we can go from Mannheim to Stuttgart? No. Whether we can go from Würzburg to Stuttgart? No. We can go from only two nodes. None of them are Stuttgart. Okay, as we can see, none of them are Stuttgart. Can we go from Kassel to directly Stuttgart, this our destination node? No. We can only go to some other node. Okay. So this is why we are, this is how we are applying breadth first search, and then we go to the next set of vertices from this Würzburg. Can we go to any other node? Yes, these two nodes are there, Erfurt, Nuremberg. So everyone, please pardon us for our German pronunciations. Our German pronunciation is not, we do not know that much German, so our pronunciation is really please pardon it. But anyway, you please understand the idea, the thought. So from Nuremberg we can go to Stuttgart. Okay. So as you can see, these are the ways. So as we have discussed further, there can be three, four different ways. You can go from Frankfurt, Mannheim, Karlsruhe, then Munich, then from Nuremberg to Stuttgart. We can go from Kassel, Munich. These are the ways. But the shortest path will be, the minimum number of vertices are being covered in this way. Okay, Würzburg, Nuremberg, Stuttgart. So each visited vertex, again, we have to explore and extend the search to its neighbors. And we do this only once for each vertex. We do not like backtrack our path. And we maintain the information about the vertices. So which vertex have been visited already, which are yet to be explored, that we maintain. Now here, let us see this animated example of a breadth first search. So the black ones are explored already, gray ones are queued to be explored. So at this point, none of the nodes are explored. None of the vertices are explored. All are yet to be explored. So first will be the root node, which is A, this one. Okay, this is to be explored now. Now see, the second level, okay, explore the graph level by level. First visit vertices one step away from root node. So this is a root node, one step away, B and C. A, B, C. Then we go to this vertex. This vertex we have D and D, and at the same time, another level is crossed. Explore the vertex level by level, and one step away from root node, then two step away from root node. So you can guess at the last step, we will go into this node. Let us see again. C, D, no, E, yes, F, G. So that is the basic concept. We go level by level. First visit vertices one step away from the root node, then two step away from the root node. Each visited vertex we have gone to, that has to be explored. Extend the search to its neighbors, and only once for each vertex. It is not like A, B, E, H, and then again we are backtracking H, E, B, A, nothing like that. Okay. And we maintain information about the vertices. Which vertices have been visited? Which are yet to be explored, we note that in a queue. Okay. So, Rahul, would you like to say anything else on this?
Nothing. I would like to see the is there any kind of procedure to draw this BFS, or we are doing just I mean, you are saying that a graph can be converted in a BFS.
Yeah.
So, is there a way?
Yeah, obviously. So we will show you an example on BFS. So this is a queue to explore. So this graph, you can see, is pentagon, and in the pentagon, I think it's pentagon 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, yes. There is a star, okay? So 1 is connected to 4, 4 is connected to 10, to 9, 8. These are the outside pentagon. 2, 6, 7, 5, and 3 form a star. Now 3 and 4 is connected, 6 and 10 is connected, 7 and 9 is connected, 5 and 8 is connected, 2 and 1 is not connected. We have noted the vertices here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. None of them are visited yet. So whether it is visited, false. So once one vertex is visited, we will change from false to true. We do not know who is the parent vertex of another vertex, right? So what is a parent vertex? A parent vertex is a vertex from which we have gone to another vertex. So if we go from 3 to 4, if we go this way from the vertex 3 to the vertex 4, then 3 is the parent of 4, okay? And currently we have initiated, as this is an algorithm, you understand. So we have initiated the levels with the initial value of minus 1. So all the nodes are currently, all the vertices are at minus 1. And there is nothing inside the queue. Let us start first with let the root node be 6. 6 is visited. And once it is visited, we have changed whether it is visited, that column, from false to true, and the level is increased by 1, so it is currently at 0 level. And 6 is the root node, so there is no parent of it, so the parent column is empty. Currently, we have come to the node 6, so the 6 is in queue to be explored. Now from 6, where can we go? From 6, we can go to 5, we can go to 2, we can go to 10. So these are the three vertices we will go into one by one. So let us start by going to the numerically small smallest number. So 2, I think we will go to 2. Yes. So 2, 5, and 10. You can see 2 is visited. So it is true. 2's parent is 6. From 6, we have come into 2. And 5, and the level is 1 more than 6, right? So from 6, this was 6. And from 6, we have come into 2, 5, and 10. Okay. So 2's level is 1. 5's level is 1. Parent is 6. 10 is also visited. Parent is 6. Obviously, 10's parent is 6. 10's level is 1. From 6, we go to 2, 5, and 10. Now, these numbers are in the queue. Now, from these three numbers, where can we go? From 2, we can go to 7. No place else, I think. From 5, we can go to 8, 6, 3. 6 is already covered. And from 10, we can go to 4 and 9. So one by one, we will see. At 2, from 2, we can go only to 7. So 7 is visited. Its parent is 2 and level is 2. So you can see 6 is the parent of 2. And from 2 vertex, we can only go to 7. So 7 is the next node which we have visited here. So 7's parent is 2, 2's parent is 6, and 7 is at level 2. So this was level 0, level 0 at 6, level 1 is 10, 2 and 5, 7 is at level 2. So remember that 5 and 10 are still in the queue. With that, 7, which we have also visited, that is also currently suspended, and we will visit that, whether we can go anywhere from 7. But we are going level by level. So first, we will see 5 and 10. So from 5, where we can go? From 5, we can go to 3 or 8. So I guess from 5, we have come to 3. 3 is visited now. 3 parent is 5. And its level is 2, same as 7. At the same time, 8 is also visited. 8's parent vertex is 5, and its level is also 2. So yeah,
I can think that now it is clear. We can visit the grab. Let me try one. So we are left with 10 now at the level 1, because we visit level by level.
Yes, yes.
So after 10, if I go, then I have to visit 4 and 9 and 6, where 6 is already visited. So I'll take 4 and 9, and this will be the in the branch of 10. So 10 will be the parent for 9 and 4. Am I correct?
Yes, exactly. Exactly. Yeah. Exactly, you are correct. So from, So from 10, we can go to 4 and 9 only. Okay. And currently, so this level 2 nodes are now in the queue, right? 7, 3, 8, 4, 9, they are currently in the queue to explore. We have to see whether we can go from any other node from these nodes, right?
Okay.
So only one node is left to be gone, right? One left to be visited. So one is there, which is not yet visited. So can we go from, where can we go? From either 4 or 8, right?
Yes.
So from 4 we can go to 1, and 8 we can go to 1. So let us see. First, we have to explore 7. So can we go from anywhere from 7? No. 7 to 9, 7 to 3, 7 to 2, all are done. Okay, all nodes are visited. Can we go from 3 anywhere? No.
I don't think so.
Yeah. But so from 4 as well as from 8, we can go to 1, right? But 8 is coming first in the queue. So let us start with 8, check with 8 first. Yes. So from, as we are talking, from 8 we can go to actually 1. Okay. Now 1 is visited. 1's parent is 8. and it is the level 3. So level 0, level 1, level 2, 4, 9, 7, 3, 8, these are in level 2, and the last one is level 3, which is 1. Okay.
Sometimes I get the question that we get a BFS and we are supposed to find that which two vertices cannot be connected in the original graph. Can we find here how to find that?
Which two vertices could not be connected?
Suppose if I say that 10 and 2 could be connected in the original graph.
10, 6, 2. Yes.
Is that correct?
There is no direct path between 10 and 2.
But we get the question that could be connected or not. How to find that?
No, 10 and 2 are in the same parallel level, same level actually.
Okay.
So there is no connection between 10 and 2, right? So we can't connect to them. Is that what you are saying?
सेम लेवल या फिर उसके नीचे वाला लेवल, ठीक है, सेम लेवल या फिर उसके नीचे वाला लेवल कनेक्ट हो सकता है. कोई भी लेवल लोगे, प्लस वन लेवल कैन बी कनेक्टेड इन द ओरिजिनल ग्राफ.
प्लस वन लेवल कनेक्ट कर सकते हैं, 10 टू 4, 10 टू 9 कनेक्ट कर सकते हैं.
ये वाला स्लाइड है कहीं पे जो ये मैं पूछ रहा हूँ, ये क्वेश्चन का स्लाइड है कहीं पे?
नहीं
है.
ये तुम बोल दो, ये तुम बोल दो,
ये तुम खत्म करो, फिर मैं देखता हूँ. ओके.
ये तुम यहाँ पे बोल दो ना, मतलब ऐसे तो नहीं है कि किसी को मतलब स्टूडेंट ही होना है, तुम बोल दो ना यहाँ पे, कुछ प्रॉब्लम नहीं है. ठीक है.
हाँ, सो
एक मिनट गैप दो, एक मिनट थोड़ा पॉज दे के दो. ओके.
सो दिव्योति, आई मीन यू एक्सप्लेन दैट हाउ टू फाइंड द बीएफएस from a graph, there is a question which I sometimes get by the in the papers, that which two vertices can't be connected in the original graph. So what I visualize here, that 10 is whatever the directed connected path are either in the same level are in the one level down.
So like 10 to 4 and 10 to 9.
Yeah, so this means 4 and 9 could be connected and there will be not a problem when we visit the 10, because I can take from 10 either 4 or 9 and their connection will be gone in the BFS. Okay.
Okay.
But I cannot connect the vertex 4 and vertex 6. Why? If I connect vertex 4 and 6, then 4 will go one level up. So it means if we are getting a vertex, if there are two vertices and they they are in the I and I plus 1 level, then they could be connected. It's not necessary they are connected in the original graph, but they could be connected, what I can see.
Okay.
If there is a gap more than that, so one is I and one is I plus 2 or I plus 3 or I plus 4, then both two cannot be connected.
So one can be connected to 8.
One could be connected to 8 because...
But not here, to 5.
Not to 5. If you connect 5 or 1, then when you were exploring 5, you would have explored 1 also at that same time.
Okay.
So what I understand from this graph BFS, that either I and I plus 1, then it could be connected. Otherwise, there is no possibility of getting connected of the vertices in original graph.
Oh, am I correct? Okay. That is new to me actually. Yeah, obviously, I think it makes a lot of sense. Makes sense. Yeah. Actually. Okay, so that's great. Thank you, Rahul, for the insight. Yeah. So we have already got our BFS tree. We will just see whether we can get anything in, we will just empty the queue. So as you can see, from 4, we can't go anywhere. All the node, all the vertices are covered. And from 9 also, we can't go anywhere, as again all the vertices are covered. So queue is also now empty and DFS tree is complete. Okay. So that is how we are doing a BFS tree, okay, of a graph, of any graph. That is the basic way. With that, we have another algorithm called BFS. Okay. So Rahul, this is our BFS tree. Okay. Do you have any other question?
Divyati, I am little bit thinking that once you started with 6, okay, and then you visited all the vertices connected to 6, like 10, 2 and 5.
Yes, yes.
What in my mind coming, if I come to 10 or 2, and rather than visiting all other 2 vertices are connected to 6, if I visit 2 again, like whatever the connected vertices are with 7, I mean 2. So from 2, 7 is connected, and then 7, I can, rather than going back to 2, I visit like 9 or 4, which is connected. And then from there, I start going from one vertices to other. Is that possible?
Yes. So there is another algorithm for that, another search algorithm, which is called depth first search and further. So the same what you asked, the question is applicable for the city problem also, which we saw that if we go from one city to another city, we want to go, what are the other cities we can visit in the way, right? Is that what you are asking?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. So BFS and DFS, all of them systematically compute the reachability. BFS actually works level by level, and it discovers the shortest path in terms of the number of edges. But whereas the depth first search actually explores a vertex as soon as it has visited the neighbors. So once it goes to another one vertex, it actually pushes all the way through. So what other vertices can we go? What are the neighboring vertex of the current vertex which we are at? That is what DFS explores. So it suspends a vertex while exploring its neighbors and keeps a track of the order in which the vertices are explored. Now, let us go into this animation which is there. So suppose this is the vertex which is our root vertex of depth first search tree. Now, in BFS, what we would do is we would go to this vertex, then this vertex, and Rahul, you can see my mouse pointer, right?
Yes, yes.
Okay, and then this vertex. But in depth first search, what we do is we go to 1, then this vertex, and we do not immediately backtrack to 1 and go to second vertex or third. This one is the second and this is the third vertex, not that. In depth first search, we go deeper. So 1, then this vertex. And can we go from any other vertex without changing our orientation, without changing our path? So we can go to this another vertex. And once we go, we see that there is no other way to go except backtracking our path. Then we return back. We go to this vertex, and in between we check whether we can go in any other path compared to this. Any other path which where the nodes are unvisited. Once we reach one node from where we can visit any other node, unvisited node, then we go into that direction. So the numbering is done in that way. 1, 2, 3, 4. Then we come to 5. 1, 2, 3, 4. From 4, we do not have any other way to go. So then 4 to 3, 3 to 2, 2 to 1. Then we come to 1 to 5. And yet we have not gone into this branch. Okay. 5. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So this is the way. You see, So 1, 2, 3, 4, we go. Then we come back. 4, 3, 2, 1. Then we see 5. From 5, where we can go? 6 and 8. So first we go to 6. Then we go as much as possible, as far as possible with 6. So from 6, we can go to 7. After 7, there is no other point where we can go. Then we go to, we go back, backtrack our path. And then we, at 5, we have another unvisited node, that is 8.
Yeah, so, I can understand now that this is kind of the same thing which I asked you. Yeah. So can we have some kind of procedure like we had for BFS?
Yes. So one thing I would like to just mention that this numbering is not same as the BFS graph numbering. Okay, this is a different structure. This is just a different numbering. This numbering does not have any connection with the other graphs.
Okay.
So let us start with the same graph that we have used in BFS. We will use for DFS also, and we will make a DFS tree of the same graph. Okay. So as we know, 6 we are taking as the root node. 6 is the root node, and so one difference between the BFS and the DFS is that in breadth first search we use a queue. Okay, queue we stand one after another, one before another. So the first item which is inserted, that comes out, and here we use a stack. A stack is different from a queue. So here it is a last in first out structure. Those who have studied data structure, they already know stack is a last in first out structure. So the item which goes in at the last will pop at first. Okay. So anyway, we will see that in motion in picture a little while later. So 6 is our root node, right, Rahul? So from 6, we are updating one counter here. And these are the vertices as we have done in previously. And we are just updating the whether it is visited one particular node. Okay. And so we are just seeing that what is the, counter, one counter of visiting we are keeping. So at I equals to 0, the counter equals to 0, so the first node is visited. So that is 6. Okay. Sorry. Then from 6, we can see that we can go to 2, and we have suspended the vertex 6, the exploring of the vertex 6, and we have gone to 2. So 2 is now visited, and after the counter is updated to 1. Okay. Sorry. Just a minute. So now the counter is updated to 1. So 2 is the next. Then we will see that we will suspend the exploring of the node 2 as well. We will keep it in stack above 6. And from 2, we will go to the next node, which can be explored. That is 7. So 7 is at counter value 2. 6 was at counter value 0. 2 was at counter value 1. So after 6 was 0, then 2, then we have come to 7 from 2. Right? And that way we can proceed. From 7, where we can go? From 7, we can go to 9 and 3. And we have come from 2 only. Right? So we will go to the numerically smallest number. I think we can go to 9 as well. Okay. So here we have gone to 3, and the 7 is in the stack of suspended vertices now. And from 3, now 3 is visited, and from 3 where we can go? From 3 we can go to 4, we can go to 5. So let us go to 4. Now 4 is visited, tree is in the stack, and the current version of the tree looks like this. 6, from 6 we have come to 2, 2 to 7, 7 to 3, 3 to 4. Then from 4, where we can go? From 4 we can go to 1. So 1 is now visited, and now the counter value is at 5. 4 is in the stack of suspended vertices. Similarly, we go to from 1, we can go to 8. The counter value is at 6. The tree looks like 6, 2. Then 7 is the parent of 3. 3 is the parent of 4. 4 is the parent of 1. 1 is the parent of 8. Okay. Can we go any other way from 8? So 1 has come, led us to 8. 8, we can go to 9 only and 5 only. So 5 is not yet explored. 9 also is not yet explored. We will go to 5. So 5 is now in the stack. And we have come to 5. Now from 5, we can go to 3. We can go to 6. Nowhere else. But both of these nodes are already covered. 3 is visited and 6 was our root node. The currently, we are left with 9 and 10. So now, we are actually, we have no other vertex which we can explore without changing our direction. So from 5, we actually start backtrack. Now currently 5 is in the stack. So from 5, we eliminate, as you see, the last in was 5, and we have eliminated now. Now we have out, taken it out, popped it out. So from 5, previously the counter of 5 was 7, so that's 7 counter value only. We are popping 5. So from 5, we can backtrack to 8 and check whether we can go to 9 and 10 from 8. So can we go to 8?
Okay, from 8 to 9, I guess.
So we have come to 5 now. And as we know, from 5, we have. We are going back as there is no more nodes to be covered. Okay. So from 5, we go back to 8. And 8 is popped from the stack. So can we go from anywhere from 8? Yes.
I think we can go. 9 yes. is reachable from
it. Yes. Yeah. So 9 is visible from here. 9 is reachable. And can we go to 10 from 9?
Yes. Yes.
Yes. So 9 is 10 is also reached. So as we know that there is no more nodes to be covered, so this is our DFS tree. Now we see, we will see whether still we will try to empty the.
I just found one thing here. I just picked something in my mind that once we got back to 5, we came back. Okay.
Yes.
Because we there was no connection.
Yes.
And from 8 we got 9. What I am thinking, if 9, there was a connection between 9 and 5, then we would have not gone back to 8.
Yes. Yes. Exactly. Exactly.
That is giving me one more answer to one more question, that what the edges cannot be connected in the original graph.
Mm-hmm.
So if elements of two branches which has different root, I mean root are same, they are in different branches, they okay. cannot be connected. Similarly, 5 and 10 cannot be connected.
Similarly, 5 or 10 obviously cannot be connected because they are at yes. two different branches.
Yes, 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 yes. yes. So exactly. here is a root node for us to think mm-hmm. is that 8. And after 8, we got 9 here and 5 here. So 5 and 9 cannot be connected. 5 and 10 cannot be connected. Other than that, 6 and 9. Can it be connected?
What do you think?
So if there is a connection between 6 and 9, then we would have followed the same path because there is no effect.
Okay.
So as we visited, as we left here, after okay. 6 we visited 2, we could be visiting 6, 2 and left 9 and come back to 9. So that okay. could be connected because they are in the same branch one way. Okay. They are yeah. not they are not being partitioned by any node.
Okay.
So at 8 we are getting two different branches, and those branch vertices of those branches cannot be connected. So same thing in DFS, if two vertices are in different branches, they cannot be connected in the original graph. And in the BFS, we found that if two vertices has more than one level gap, then they cannot be connected.
So here in DFS, 1 and 7, these two vertices can be connected, right?
Yeah, 1 and 7 could be connected.
But 5 and 10 could not be connected.
Could not be connected.
Okay. So as thank you, Rahul. Thanks very much for that very insightful talk. As we have, you have seen that all our nodes, all our vertices are visited. We have got our DFS tree. Now we will just check the stack whether we can visit any other node. But we know that all the nodes are visited. So from 1, we can't go anywhere else which we have not gotten. 4 and 8 is already in the node, so 1 is gone. 4 also, we can go only to 1, 3 and 10. All of them are here. So 4 will be cancelled out. Popped from the stack. 3, the same case. It will be, we will take 3 to 4. We can go to 5 or we can go to 7. All of whom are in the DFS tree. So 3 will be gone. 7 is also the same thing. 7 to, we can go to 3, 2 and 9. All of where we have already been to, we have explored those vertices. 7 will be gone. Then we go to 2. 2, from 2 we can go to 6 and 7. All of them are explored. So 2 is left, and what is remaining is 6. 6 was our root node, and we have gone, we have explored all the nodes, all the vertices which we can go from 6. So 6 will also be removed from the stack. So that is how actually DFS works. Okay. Now that ends our, all the things that we have wanted to show you today. Okay. So just one few small things. So as we are telling in the first initial part, we will show you brief, we will name some of the applications of graph theory. So in computer science, we can use it in social networking, structure of a website, etc. We can study evolution of a language from the graph theory. We can see this is also a tree actually. Okay, this is an evolution of a language, and this actually represents a tree. And in biology, there is a good application, as we can discuss the spreading of COVID virus in different regions. In chemistry, we can see a make a natural model of the molecule, but the vertices represent atoms, edges represent bonds. So just as a last playing thing, Rahul, we will just see one GeoGebra suit on graph theory. Is this visible?
Yes.
Yeah. So Rahul, you know that what we are studying is that a planar graph, right? Mm-hmm. And what is a planar graph? We already know that it can be drawn in such a way that no edges can cross each other. So yes. Can you tell me which of these graphs are can be planar graphs?
So first one could be planar because any diagonal vertices I can take from round up
kind of like thing. This.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So that is the only thing, and these graphs will be difficult to guess from here. So just show you the solution that this graph, which was looking very complicated here, this is actually a planar graph, a merry-go-round kind of thing, and these two are not planar.